Okay, hello everybody. I'm very happy and excited, I must say, to be here. My name is Galia GRANOT. I work in the Ruderman Family Foundation, for whom you heard Shira Ruderman in the morning. She's the director. The Ruderman Family Foundation is a family foundation that promotes inclusion in Israel and in the United States. It was written that I'm from United States, but it's not. I'm from Israel, so English is not my first language, so I hope it will be okay today. So we are here today to talk about internship. The topic is the power of internships and summer jobs for creating jobs. We believe, and I hope, and I think that also my friends here, the panelists, believe also that the internships and the summer jobs are very effective interventions to include people in the job market, in jobs that suit their abilities and their occupational aspirations. So before I start, and I would also like to present you our model that we're involved in, I would like first to introduce my friends and panelists. Peter Furlong, and I'm sorry if I will not pronounce it right, from KARE organization Ireland, right? You will talk about the search project.
Project search.
Yeah. Erin RIEHLE. From Cincinnati, USA. You will also talk about the search project. And Laura Stokley from Canada. Laura, you will talk about the summer employment program. Okay, so let's start my presentation. Okay, so we will talk about internship programs. And how do you go? Ah, okay. So before we go and focus on the model, we need to understand the magnitude of the mission. We're talking about almost 2 days about the need and about the inclusion in the in employment. So first I want to show you the findings. In Israel, you can see that 57% of people with disabilities are working in the job market, comparing to 78% in the general population. And in United States, you can see that the gap is severe. We're talking about 35% comparing to 78% of the population. So we're here for 2 days. We understand that this is a very crucial issue, and we have to understand, we have to be very innovative and to think about new solutions. And before we'll go and dig in, we have to understand what are the challenges. We know we're talking about that there are 1 billion all over the world people with disabilities. In Israel, we're talking about 1 million of people. Employers, people with disabilities are important assets, so why? Why is it so hard for the employers or for the organization to recruit people with disabilities? So we recognize a few key barriers that we all know that we need to break them. So the first one, and I think that we spoke about it a lot here, is the accessibility. It's not easy to create accessible workspaces, and we understand that it requires knowledge, motivation, changing the mindset, and the money. Unfortunately, when we work with organizations, many times we find that many organizations lack at least of one of those requirements. Another thing that I think it's a human thing that we all need is sensitivity and patience, but especially when we work with people with disabilities at the beginning, especially the first stage when they just start the work in the organization, sometimes the outputs and the performances will be lower. So it takes time, and also the organization needs to understand it, and if you provide good support, they can decrease the gap and can improve their performances. The recruitment is very, it's not a simple thing to do. The classification text, they're not matched and not always adapted for the needs for people with disabilities. And also, we hear a lot, I have here a Daphna Maor from the government, and a nite, I just say from Israel, they're all here. We're talking about a lot of time the organization, they say, we want, please give us, bring us the candidates with disabilities, we want to hire them. But many times it's very hard to find them. So this is another barrier. And the disciplinary sanction, what happens if you want to fire a person with disability? Can you fire a person with disability? If it doesn't work, can you do anything? This is also something that we need to talk about. And the last, and I think this is an issue or that we spoke about it a lot, stigma. Yes, stigma, and many employers, they hold the stereotypical opinions, and usually they will evaluate or underestimate the abilities of people with disabilities. So now, we're talking about the solution. We believe that the internship programs is a very good solution that can cope with those barriers. Firstly, we will hear about what's happening in other countries, but in Israel and also in the States, you can talk more about it. The internship, there are no contractual obligation. A person, there is the relationship between employer and intern is not like the relationship between employer and employee. If the employer is not satisfied from the intern work, so he can dismiss him. It's very, very, it's limited in time. It's very specific. So it's easier for the employer to accept it or to want to take part of it. I think for the people with disabilities or for the interns, they achieve three important things. First, networking. It's very important to be part of the job market. Maybe it's their first chance, or real chance, to go and to network, to see people that are already work, and to be part of it, and this can build them the path, after it, to the first work. Another thing is the on-the-job training. There's also, you know, the things that they learn during the internship. It depends in whatever they do. But I think also what is very important, the soft skills and the experience that they go to work. They participate in a team meeting. They understand what is it that you have a boss to say. They go on, they have to get in time so they can achieve and they can experience many important things that will help them in the future. And in the end, the CV. The internship will be aligned in the CV and they can go and say we did this and this, and this can be very helpful in the future. Okay, I would like to share with you one example of our program in the United States. Maybe you know, both of you, this program. Transition to Work. This is a program that is in the States. It's a collaboration between CJP, the Ruderman Family Foundation, and the Jewish Vocational Service. The goal of this internship program is to promote quality employment for people with disabilities. You can see the outcomes. It's amazing. 70% of the participants joined the job market, and what is more interesting, that 94% of them succeeded to maintain and to stay in their jobs. So when we're talking about the best, this is our best practice, and the important components of this program, we can see that in this program, we have three stages. The first stage is the internship. The second stage is a career training, and the last and third is the placement. So it's a year a program. As you can see, in the internship program, they go for 144 hours. They go for, they can do interns in many places, in hospitals, restaurants, hotels. It's very diverse. And so they do their internship there. They usually come in groups. 6 to 8 interns, they do it there. And in the organization, there will always be a mentor, a point person, he is from the organization, and he is in charge, that the intern will feel convenient, that everything will be okay, and you know he has to be the connection between the organization and also the program, and of course the interns. The interns participate in workshops, that the workshops give them skills and also empower them to understand how to behave in a competitive place and give them all the skills and the tools they need to adjust the work. And also, as needed, they get personal support. During the time, also a career coaching is coming into the picture, and they help them to go and to try to feel to get jobs, to go to interviews. Sometimes they even go with them to interviews. And in the end, it's a very long process that eventually you saw the outcomes that more than 70% of them succeeded to get jobs. It's very important to distinguish one of the components. It's the employers' relationship development. As you know, it's not easy to do it, and we need the organization that they would like to be part of it. And later we'll talk about how can we recruit the organization that to be part of it, because it's not easy, I must say. But it's things that we're all the time, we work with the employers, we have to talk with them to give them skills and tools, how to recruit, how to hire, what things they need to do in order that the people in their organization and the interns or people with disabilities, employees with disabilities, will feel better and can succeed in their jobs. And we need to recruit more and more intern jobs. I would like to say, you know, we believe in the foundation that we need to be a role model. So I want to introduce you, my three interns that I'm very attached to. You see Josh, you see his name. Josh he started a year ago as an intern in the foundation. He is visually impaired. He's now finishing his second degree. He's amazing. You saw this presentation, did you like it? I hope so, how it looks. So he did everything. He designed it, and he did also Shiraz's presentation in the morning. He's very talented. And today he's working in the Ruderman Family Foundation in Israel. He's in a full-time job. He's a coordinator of our network. You see Sagi next to him. He has ALS, he's in his first degree. He runs and he controls all our digital and social media work in the foundation. And Svika, he's another intern, they're all students. He's now starting his second degree, and he has a physical disability, and he finished very successfully the internship in the foundation. And now he is working in one of the programs that the foundation supports. So as an employer, I must say that I really recommend you to try this intervention because it is very powerful and impactful, and I think also good. So this is me. This I think will skip. This, you can see those are the... Now we're developing a new program in Israel, and as I said, our partners are here to develop it. So those are the components that work in Israel. You see it's very similar to the components of the transition program. The difference is here that we want to, the students, the interns, will participate and they will take academic courses. We will work with the academia to do it. And also they will get academic credits for their internship. So it's very similar, but it's a little bit different because... So this is us for the Ruderman Family Foundation. And now I'm very honored. And you need this, I think.
Thank you.
Okay. Peter will share with us your best practices in the search project in the hospital. What you're doing there. So the stage is yours.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm just waiting for the slides to come up when the technical man does that. My name is obviously Peter Furlong. I work for an organization called KARE. We work with people with intellectual disabilities, children and adults in County Kildare in the Republic of Ireland. The main focus of our organization is providing opportunities for people to get work, to get jobs, to get paid jobs in the open labour market. One of the groups of people that we work with, obviously, is younger people. And whilst looking to develop a service that would most suit their needs, we came across and saw a project by the name of Project Search. And as an organisation, we thought this would have been something that would have been really, really valuable for us. So we investigated, found out about it, and as an organisation, we signed up to become part of Project Search. Erin, who's here on my left, is one of the founders of Project Search in America, and she'll fill us in a little bit more on those sorts of details as well. I'm going to focus in on the impact that this has had on young people with intellectual disabilities in Ireland. I suppose just to briefly put it into context, Project Search was originally developed in Cincinnati Children's Hospital in Ohio in the USA in 1996. And Erin and Susie Ruskowski, if I got the name right, were the two people who came up with the concept and the idea in relation to it. In early 2013, CARE approached NACE General Hospital, which would be a medium-sized hospital in the community of Kildare. And we looked to set up a business-led collaboration plan to introduce the first ever Project Search program into Ireland. And the success of the project has had a really positive impact for interns, staff and families. We're now in our fourth year, and just to very briefly talk about our outcomes, the national average in Ireland for employment for people with disabilities in Ireland is about 6%. In year one in Project Search, we had 100%. We have 10 interns per year. In year one, we had 100% outcomes for people to get jobs. Year two and year three, we have had 80% outcomes. And the reason we were at 80 is that one of the people in each of the years, one went on to further education and another person dropped out. So though I think those figures demonstrate the success of the project, what it's about. I suppose just again, NACE General Hospital, it provides an inpatient general medical and surgical and acute psychiatric services and a 24-hour emergency service to its immediate catchment area in Kildare and West Wicklow, which is a population of about 220,000. And the hospital's catchment area completely mirrors our catchment area for the people that we work with. The sorts of services that are provided, as you see, there's a whole list of various. It's a typical hospital. And when we started out in year one, we tried to identify 10 departments in the hospital. The hospital itself didn't force any departments to get involved. They looked for volunteers. And in advance of it coming over, Erin and Susie came to Ireland and did a number of things. The first thing was supported the hospital to identify the departments, because it was quite daunting for the hospital at first as to how would this work in a little hospital in little old Ireland on the edge of Europe, when this is coming from big, huge Cincinnati in America. Erin and Susie would have literally walked around the hospital and pointed things out to people, pointed things out to the department. In year one, we had 10 departments. We're now in year four. We have 22 departments in the hospital who want to be involved. There's a fight every time the rotations change as to who's getting an intern, which creates a bit of drama and a bit of excitement for us to deal with. And the two coordinators in the hospital, who, by the way, Caroline, are watching it online, on the web at the moment, Andy and Trish. So I told them I'd mention them, so they owe me €50 for mentioning their names. So, as I say, the departments are really, really involved in the whole process. Press the wrong button. So why did NACE Hospital agree to get involved in Project Search? Alice Kinsler, who's the general manager of the hospital, she would say they couldn't find any valid reason not to get involved. When they started at first, they were very, very hesitant. They didn't know how this would work, how people with intellectual disabilities would fit in. CARE and the Project Search, so Erin and Susie, met with the hospital management. This was very much a local thing. It wasn't that the hospital got permission nationally. The hospitals in Ireland are run by a national health service. We don't have the Irish health service in the main is publicly funded. Our private hospital system is very, very, very small. So, as usual with these bigger sorts of organisations, decisions can take a long time to happen. But thankfully, Alice and the hospital went off and did a solo run on this one for everybody's benefit. And as I say, Project Search identified the departments and worked with the departments to identify the tasks. CARE identified two staff members from within our team who are based in the hospital. And their role is to support each individual through the rotations and through every aspect of it. And that also includes social issues, it includes personal issues, it includes everything that could happen to a young person. I didn't say at the start, but Project Search is aimed towards, in Ireland, it's aimed towards school leavers. Young people leave school at 18, and the group that we work with are, in the main, they're 18, up until the age of about 24. But we have had one or two other older people who've got involved because it was the right thing for them. But in I suppose you could call this, is in Ireland, this is an opportunity for people to do further education, whereas the reality is people with intellectual disabilities in Ireland have very little opportunity to do third level education of any type. So what does the hospital get out of it? So it's an approved program model, and it's implemented by professional on-site coordinators, and it has the backup of a professional organisation like CARE. The training and support is provided by the coordinators on the job, in the work site, and it means that initially in departments, the burden isn't put on top of staff in the hospital, because obviously they have enough to be doing with the patients, but our coordinators will introduce the person to the work. And then the coordinator's big job is to develop natural supports so that the individuals themselves stand up on their own two feet. The first thing that people learn when they go to Project Search, for all of them, is that they have to learn how to get to the hospital. And in Ireland, in rural Ireland, which is where we're based, that can be a very big challenge, because we don't have metro stations or underground or anything like that. So on day one, on the 1st of September, each intern has learnt to travel independently. And that is such a huge deal, and it absolutely gives people independence after the project. In relation to the hospital, as you're aware, in Ireland, the Celtic Tiger got quite sick and died, and the country went into meltdown in around 2008. So when we started Project Search, there was no recruitment happening in the hospital. So this was, from a morale point of view, this was absolutely massive for the hospital, that people, new young people came in to start doing new things. So the interns have proved to be positive, reliable, dedicated, hardworking. They're very, really good timekeepers. There's no issue in relation to sickness. They've brought smiles across the hospital. And the sort of tasks, I won't necessarily go through them all, but rest assured that the jobs that the interns are doing are real jobs. There's nothing made up. These jobs have an impact on patients. For example, the interns are working in medical records. So when you or I go for an outpatient's appointment, we want our information to get from A to B. Our interns take responsibility for tracking files, for tracking stuff that goes on. The simple job, the most important job in the hospital is, in Ireland anyway, is when you walk into the hospital that you put the gel in your hands. NIS Hospital has 68 of those bottles, and we have one young man who makes sure that those bottles are filled every morning, which in turn means that HICWA, which is the Irish regulatory body who inspect hospitals, NIS Hospital is one hospital in the country that never runs out of hand gels. And from the hospital management's perspective, that's absolutely fantastic. So the benefits for the interns, they're learning a broad range of skills. They get the opportunity to have a professional CV done. We have what we call a business advisory council, and this is where we have upwards of 20 local businesses who've come to work with us to support the interns to prepare their CVs, to practice mock interviews. And in our group last year, two of the interns got jobs directly from members of the Business Advisory Council. So that took the pressure off us having to find 10 jobs for people. The confidence that people gained is immeasurable, and I'm going to show you a tiny little video now in a couple of moments, and I think that'll demonstrate that. The recommendations, and I suppose from our perspective, we really want to see this develop in Ireland, because we really see this as a model for young people, particularly young people with intellectual disabilities, who there's a huge gap between leaving school and getting out into the world of work. How the project runs is each intern will do three rotations. It sort of sits on a school year, September to June. Each rotation is 12 weeks in length. And the object of the exercise is that they get three different opportunities. The third internship is very much focused in on what it is that the person wants to do afterwards, what sort of job that they want to get. The first one is very much what's it like to work. The second one is focusing in on, you know, stamina, you know, attention to detail, stuff like that. The third one is preparing to get out of here, to move on in their lives. People do 4 hours per day, 4.5 hours now actually, 4.5 hours per day on the shop floor, working in the departments. We also have a fantastic link with our local education and training board, who come into the hospital every morning and provide an education platform. This is a huge development in Ireland. Our education and training board, which is the state agency that's responsible for education, have up until this point not got involved with people with intellectual disabilities. So this is a huge jump forward for us in the country, and we're hoping that this is something that'll be mirrored across the place. What people get out of it is they get competitive, marketable, transferable skills. Yes, people with intellectual disabilities struggle to maybe move skills from one place to the other, but the biggest thing they get is confidence and to know that, yes, I can work and I'm going to work. The support for the interns, as I say, we've talked about that. It's an on-the-job and phased support. Adaptations are put in if they're required, and there's smooth transitions into departments. Life after project search. So each participant is supported to gain and maintain the job of their choice in the open labour market, a paid job, nothing less than minimum wage. Each participant learns transferable skills that can be used in a variety of job opportunities, and each candidate receives support from CARE to develop further areas of their lives. So as well as supporting people to get a job, CARE as an organisation, we step in and support people in relation to their future living arrangements, relationships, whatever it is that they might want to do. Because we realise that having a job isn't the only thing in a person's life. And it's a focus in on a career, not just a job. So we're there for the long term for people. And I suppose the major thing is that what Project Search has done to Kildare. Kildare, being a small town, we have put people with intellectual disabilities in the centre of our community. People with everybody in the community has some contact with the hospital, be for good or for bad reasons. People with intellectual disabilities are visible in their community in relation to that. Also, Ireland's National Health Service have really taken to this model and have spoken about looking about developing this across the country. I just want to show you just 2 minutes of a DVD and that's it. Thanks very much. Hopefully the DVD will work.
And socialisation with other members of the team and becoming very much part of our team by coming and having tea breaks with us. The on-site coordinators were a huge asset to us in that they helped the interns develop that they could actually take on new roles within the department.
Shane has been involved with
I just want to say that you see this movie and you cannot you're smiling. And you said that that now the hospital, they fight on interns, and they understand what is the, you know, the young energy that they bring into the organization. And we're talking about win-win situations. So energy and environment is good for everyone in the organization. So thank you very much. And now we really, Erin, okay, from United States. Also, we'll talk about the search project.
My name's Erin Riley, and I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio. I actually work at Cincinnati Children's Hospital. And I have to say, my talk is, it fits really well with Peter's, because he gave you a lot of detail, and I'm going to give you some of the bigger picture details about Project Search. I will also say that Peter mentioned that Public Health Ireland is looking into the program, and we've actually been approached and asked to start 10 more projects in Ireland, and we hope that we'll be doing that with CARE. And what Peter, the examples he gave you, I couldn't be prouder to hear when he talks about it, because it's very closely aligned with the way all of our programs run. So we consider ourselves, I'm actually a nurse, I'm not a disability expert, and we started this program 20 years ago because we recognized that hospitals make a lot of money providing medical care to people with disabilities, but they've never been very welcoming in terms of employment. At best, most hospitals simply look at people with disabilities as a good source of lifelong volunteers. And so we recognize that people with disabilities have much more to contribute, that they are inherently capable. But like the rest of us, in order to work, they must have training. It can't be expected that they'll walk off the street and into a job and have all of the skills they need to do that job and to compete. What's missing in the United States, and I think in many places in the world, are programs that provide people with disabilities with the skills they need to go out and find jobs. And so we are a training and preparation program. In general, we follow four things, and Peter talked about each one of these. First of all, we focus on young people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. That's our focus. That's who we work with. We consider them to be a population that often have fewer opportunities, so we make sure that we target them and we believe in them. We have one goal and one goal only, and that is competitive employment. We consider it a failure when the young people who come through our program leave without employment. It is about total workplace immersion. You know, sometimes I think we focus so much on training young people with disabilities and all of these programs. We seldom work on training people without disabilities on how to work in a business with people with disabilities. And so in our program, we teach both groups. At the same time that we're teaching young people with disabilities and giving them the skills they need to work, we are also teaching mentors and employees within departments on how to best work most effectively with people with disabilities. And in essence, it takes away that fear factor and it allows everybody to move forward. As Peter mentioned, our interns rotate through three different internships because they, like everybody else, deserve choice. And they haven't often had many opportunities to even figure out what they want to do. And then last but not least, we work with them on customized job search assistance, helping them find a job. And then we work with them to help keep a job, because I have yet to know a person with a developmental disability who has lost their disability just because they get a job. It doesn't happen. And so to put a lot of time and resources into finding a job and to put no resources into helping to keep that job really waste a lot of money. So in Project Search, we are a three-legged stool. We are training, employment, and follow along, which Peter mentioned. I will say, in terms of our statistics, just so you know, we are far from perfect. We have currently over 450 programs in 45 states. We also have programs in Canada, England, Scotland, Ireland, Holland, Bahrain, Australia, and Portugal, with more countries due to come online next year. We are an evidence-based program. Our programs are required to put data into a database. We track that data. We make sure that the data stacks up against the money that's being spent. We kick programs out if they're not meeting employment objectives, because we cannot afford to waste precious resources. 94% of our sites entered data. That means 6% didn't, and then we follow up with those 6%, and there will be ramifications. Of all of our young people who went through Project Search, factoring in the 6% of the sites that did not input their data, so factoring that in, our overall employment rate right now is 75.5%. So that's of the 450 programs around the world. What we do know from our database is that 33% are employed by our host businesses, and 60% of those, 67% who go on to be employed, are employed in the host community. It's interesting, at Children's Hospital in the past 20 years, we have hired 70 of our graduates. And even though that sounds like a lot, it is still less than 1% of our workforce, and therefore it is insufficient. So at Cincinnati Children's Hospital, we have set a target of a minimum of 3% of our workforce being people with disabilities. The average hourly wage in the United States is $9.61 on per hour, and the average hours worked per young person employed are 25.4 a week. This is a, I wanted you to see this, and again, Peter spoke to this. If we look at all of our businesses, 3/4 of them are in hospitals. They tend to be very good sites. They are rich in intern opportunities. They're a microcosm of the working world. Just about anything you want to teach, any skill you want to teach, you can teach in a hospital and take back out into the community, whether it's clerical, whether it's stores, materials management, transportation. They're very transferable skills. That said, 1/4 of our programs are in different types of industries. So we have programs in the government and in jails. We have programs in universities and colleges. We have programs in the hospitality industry, conference centers and hotels. We have programs in nursing homes and rehab facilities. And then we have quite a few programs in banking, biotech, distribution centers, insurance, parks and zoos, pharmaceutical companies, retail, and utilities. So we really, at this point in our career, we're getting approached by businesses more than we're approaching them. And we rarely say no, but there are some rules that the businesses need to abide by. So I wanted to show you just a couple things, and I think this is the key part of Project Search that often gets overlooked. And that is, when we go into a community, we are asking all the players in that community who have anything to do with disability to actually work together. And that includes the schools, the government, the family, because what happens is that there's many initiatives, but everybody has their own initiative, and they seldom sit down and partner. And so, and that really does nothing more than waste time, money, and talent. And so we bring together, we start by bringing together the partners in a community. And then we move that community and that relationship into a business. And we work with them on changing their definition of employment, on making sure that they're all following the same outcome, that they're working toward the same goal. But this is what I want to talk about. I think that really, collaboration is the hardest thing in our business, and we don't talk about it enough, because what we really do, we cooperate. And cooperation and collaboration are infinitely different. So this is a great example of cooperation. Cooperation is saying to a couple groups, let's work on something. But what they really do they go back, they take the problem, and they take it back to their school or their agency, and they use their same people within their walls to solve the problem. And they solve it in the same way they've always solved everything. And so you could have five groups that are cooperating, but you're going to get different outcomes from all five. That's cooperation. That is not collaboration. And in Project Search, what we try to do is take representatives from each of the entities, pull them from their business, have them join a centralized team, have one definition of success, one definition of how that will be funded. We make it evidence-based, and that's actually transformational collaboration. It's the hardest part of our model. It's why we're most successful. You know, I want to end by just telling you a quick story. And this is, I have permission to mention her name. Her name is Gretchen Ketters, and Gretchen has Down syndrome. She doesn't read and she doesn't count. And in my head, when I first started this program, I couldn't imagine how a person who couldn't count or read could ever work in a hospital. That seemed impossible to me. But to Peter's point, we went out and we partnered with groups like CARE. We partnered with the school district. We partnered with people who knew how to make it work. And here's what I learned, and this is what people need to understand, not people in this room, but people in this world. And that is that there are multiple ways to do things, and that businesses, all of those things can work within our walls, but you have to show us. So for example, Gretchen puts every supply that is needed within 28 rooms in a hospital. And that's the standard number of rooms that are stocked by what's called a stocking technician. And Gretchen is a stocking technician. She works full time. She gets paid the standard salary that everyone else does. And here's how she counts. So if you look at the picture on the right, those are pictures of what I call baby nipples, but you call them what? Can you help me? What is it, a nook, a teat?
Teat.
I believe that in many places they're called baby teats, and it's what you put on the end of the bottle that the baby takes their formula out of, yeah? Gretchen has to put 20 of those in all 28 rooms, but she can't count to 20. So I can either say she can't do the job, or I can figure out how to get her to 20. And it turns out that there are dozens of ways to get her to 20. And here's what we do. It's the picture on the right. We took 20 pictures, we taped them together, we laminated it, and she takes a baby teat, she puts it on top of each picture, she folds it up, she puts it in a plastic bag. How many does she have every time? 20. She never makes a mistake. Do we care if she uses this versus counting? No, we absolutely don't. What do we care about? We care that she gets the job done. So I'm just going to finish with this. Here's the tricky thing about this. I can spend all this time teaching Gretchen how to do this, and that's great, but if I don't also teach businesses that this is okay and that they will have the same goal, then there's no point to all the training that I have just done. So I just want to say thank you to Peter, thank you to you, and that's my last slide.
Wow, Erin, thank you very much. I just understood that you have 450 programs in 45 states. You have a treasure because you said that you document everything. You have a lot of data. So maybe you can share with us this data because this is treasure what you have.
Thank you.
For us. Thank you. And now Laura from Canada, she will share with us her program, the Summer Employment Transitions Program. Thank you.
Hi, so I just want to say thanks to the Zero Project for having us here. We're really happy to be here, and I'm also really happy that I packed a green shirt because apparently that's the color of the conference, so now I feel like I belong and I'm good to go. So I want to talk to you guys today about a program that we run in Canada in our little town of Sarnia called the Summer Employment Transitions Program. This is a program for students who have a disability and are in school and returning to school in the fall. So our students who take part in our program have to be between the ages of 16 and 29. That is the definition of youth in Canada. They have to have a disability and they have to be in school and returning to school in the fall. So it could be a high school student or a college or university student. And they have to have a disability. So I use the term disability very broadly. It could be an intellectual disability, physical disability, mental health illness, anything falls into that category. We give the students an 8-week paid job at minimum wage or higher, and all of our jobs are paid. We don't do any unpaid work in our summer employment program. The jobs are anywhere between 4 and 25 hours a week because we like to have a bit of a diverse work schedule because some students are able to work more, whereas some students can only work maybe 10, 12, 15 hours a week. So we have jobs in every field, retail, administrative, you can see the whole list there, and every student gets a job coach. So we hire the job coaches and they're paid through community living and then they go to work with the student at their job for the summer. So we started this project because in 1988, we had a really big problem in our community where people with a disability were graduating and there was no work for them. They were graduating high school, college, university, whatever the case may be, and they weren't getting work. So part of the reason they weren't getting work was because they had no skills. They had built up no skills while they were in school. So we saw the need to start a summer program for students. So they get to build skills, they get to have the experience of working for the summer, so when they graduate, they have an increased rate of getting employed after school. We work really closely with the schools and the parents to get the students prepared for summer, and the teachers in the schools work really closely with our program as well. So the program is run, there's a lot of work that goes into the program. It sounds simple, an 8-week program, but there's a lot of back work that goes into the program. So usually in about March, we start hiring summer job coaches. And once our summer job coaches are hired, then we move on to speaking in the schools to get the students with a disability to take part in our program. I should mention all of our job coaches are college and university students from our area. We talk to local employers. We have a 92% return rate for employers coming back to our program every year. And the reason that they come back to our program is because they say it's the smart thing to do. It's the smart business thing to do to hire someone with a disability. It's not the right thing to do, it's the smart thing to do. And that's why they come back to our program every year, because they have such good experience with our students. So we also do training for the job coaches, training for the students, and we do a parents' night. So the parents can come with their student or with their child who has a disability and meet the job coach who will be working with their child for the summer. It gives them a chance to ask any questions they have, and get really familiar with the program. So our program's been running for 28 years. We have put through 347 students with a disability since 2012, so that kind of tells you a bit about how big our program is. We have given 123 college and university students a job as a job coach since 2012, and every year we have over 60 local businesses that hire students with a disability. A lot of employers will actually hire more than one student because they have had such positive experiences with the program. The city that we come from is a little town called Sarnia, and the city of Sarnia itself hires 11 students with a disability every year. So they stand behind our program very much. So we have an employer, a quick little story about Gabe. So Robert E. Dale is an engineering firm in Sarnia, and they have hired students from us for the past 6 years. The last 3 years, they've taken two students instead of one because the quality of the work is so much better. So they had Gabe last year. And Gabe is in a wheelchair. However, he can use arm crutches on days when he's having a good day. And he got to work one day, and his office at Robert E. Dale was on the third floor, and the elevator was broken. So Gabe's always at work, 10 minutes early, 15 minutes early, model employee, and he got there, and the elevators were broken, and he panicked because he didn't think he was going to be able to get to work on time. So he actually got out of his wheelchair and pulled himself up 3 flights of stairs just to get to work on time, and then apologized when he got there for being late, even though he was still 3 minutes early for work because he's used to being there 10 minutes early. So it just goes to show you the drive and determination the students have and how appreciative they are to have their summer jobs. So a little while ago, we took a one-time snapshot just to see what our numbers were of students who had been through our program. And this snapshot is specifically speaking to students who have an intellectual disability. So you can see here, we looked at 85 students who had been through our program. 47 of them are currently employed. 5 of them are still job seeking. 6 have fallen ill with a serious illness and they cannot work. 15 returned to get post-secondary education, which is something that we're always really proud of, because a lot of students who come to our program are out of high school, but we really encourage post-secondary education in our community, so to have 15 go back was a really good number for us. 2 moved away, 10 are volunteering, and 9 felt that maybe employment wasn't for them and they didn't want to do that. So, and I do want to mention too, all of our volunteer placements are in traditional volunteer roles. We have nobody who volunteers in the for-profit sector. Every volunteer role is in a non-profit setting. And all of our jobs are minimum wage or higher. So I'll tell you a little bit about Tiffany. Usually when we do this presentation, we have a video that goes along with Tiffany because she's so fantastic, but unfortunately, because of time, we couldn't show the video today. So Tiffany has been through our summer employment program. She went through 3 times. So she came to our summer program, went back to high school, came again, went back to high school, and then decided she was going to go to post-secondary education and get a degree to work with children in a daycare. So while she was in college, she came back to our summer employment program. So she's built up skills now over the course of 3 summers. She knows what it's about to be at work. And she was so determined. She did our summer program while she was in school, did our pre-employment program for graduates, and then now she works full-time in a daycare. So, I don't know if I mentioned Tiffany has an intellectual disability, so that was kind of her course through our summer employment program. So why summer employment? I'm going to power through these next couple slides because I know I'm running out of time. I got the sign, so. Students get to gain skills and experience. They gain self-esteem, which is huge. We don't need to spend much time on that. We all know how big self-esteem is for someone who has a disability. They get to make money, which is awesome. What 18, 19, 20-year-old doesn't like to make money and go spend it on, you know, things teenagers want to spend their money on? The job coaches, this is really important to our program. The job coaches who are a part of our program come back to our community upon graduation of their university program or college program, and they become employers in our community and advocates for students with a disability. So somebody who's been a job coach in our program for 3, 4, 5 years while they're studying, they come back and then they own businesses or they're teachers or they're doctors and they advocate in our community for our program and for the students with a disability. So that's a really, you know, things kind of go full circle there. So you can see on the bottom a quote that we kind of live by with our organization. The number one indicator of successful labor market attachment for people with a disability upon graduation from school was having a paid job while in school. So that's really important for us with our summer program. So next for us, we have a toolkit that is our whole program encompassed into one toolkit so that we can basically take it to other agencies and they can start implementing their own summer employment programs. It says 14 agencies on there, but that was back in January when my presentation had to be submitted, so it's actually 16 now. So 16 other agencies in our in Ontario, so all across our province, have adopted our summer employment model. So next we're looking to go nationwide, and we're actually looking to go into the US as well. There was lots of questions in the earlier sessions about transferability of programs, and ours is easy. It's so easy. We have an online version of it. So for people who can't accommodate on-site training or can't make it to our facility for training, we can do online training as well. So that's it. I'm out of time. So thank you so much for listening.
Thank you very much, Laura. You know, the three of the, I think that all of us said that maybe at the beginning it's hard, but then when the organizations and the employers, they understand the asset and the potential that they have where they have interns, I think they want only more and more interns. So, okay, we have a little bit time for questions from the audience. Someone have a question? It's your opportunity. Yes. Okay, then.
Just a question for Laura. Do you use any employer incentives?
No, we don't use wage subsidies. That's something that we have found over the years, that when you use wage subsidies for people who have a disability, as soon as the wage subsidy is gone, the person goes as well. They're the first to go when that money runs out. So we really look at it like equal work for equal pay. The employer, when they pay somebody, they invest in that person and they are more likely to stay with that business.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you very much for this fantastic presentation. I work for Light for the World, and we're also, our job is to break down the barriers to allow disabled people to have vocational training, education, and a better life in the underprivileged world. And we've noticed that stigma against disability is a huge thing in Africa. So my question to you is very much based on, I've also worked in the private sector, and internships are great for the development of the person, but they are actually quite time-consuming for employers to put up, to recruit, to do. Do you think it could actually be a barrier, another barrier to overcome? What's your view?
I suppose I just go back to the point where working people with intellectual disabilities, that people I work with, and the model of supported employment. The reality is that people with intellectual disabilities will always struggle to gain and maintain employment without some level of support. And the other thing I suppose that's changed, I suppose, in Ireland is that we've had a huge number of people lose their jobs, and that the government, the state, is wondering how are we going to get... What happened in Ireland was that everybody was pushed into education. All the young people were pushed into education when there was no jobs. Now they can't afford to run the education system, so they're trying to get people back out to work. How do they get them back out to work? They get them back out to work through apprenticeships and also through internships. So I just think it's a model that's ripe for everybody, and why shouldn't people with disabilities have the same opportunity as that? And I totally agree in relation to the wage subsidies. When you start bringing in wage subsidies, the minute the subsidy goes, the job goes. So as an organisation, CARE, we wouldn't look at wage subsidies really.
And I wanted to say that in Project Search, and it sounds like all three of our programs, we actually put staff into the business, because you're right, it's not businesses, the people in business have jobs that they need to do. And so to expect that they can do that job and at the same time be the support person or the trainer for the person with disability isn't very reasonable. So in our model, if we put eight people into a business, we send three staff with them. And we would say that the staff do the heavy lifting and do the bulk of the teaching of the skills.
Thank you. Is there another question? Yes.
Hello, thank you very much for your presentation. It's very interesting. I'm from the ONCE Foundation in Spain. I have two questions. One is about the minimum and maximum duration of the internships that make it effective, if you have any opinion on that. And the other thing is that, is there any formal document that you sign with the company, employer, the internship, the person with disability, and the organization providing the job coach? And is there any legislation on that on your countries?
Thank you for your question. I wanted to ask it.
I suppose from CARE's perspective, CARE has a contract with the hospital, which I suppose it was drawn up in partnership with the main project search thing. When I say it's a contract, it's renewed. We renew it every year, that all sides are happy to keep going with it. In relation to the interns themselves, they don't have a contract, but they have the right to walk out anytime they want. Nobody's forced to be there. We have an agreement with everybody in relation to the service that CARE will provide to them. It just so happens that that service might be in Project Search, but it might be other aspects of their lives.
You know, the link of the internships like you did before.
In relation to the three different rotations that people do, I suppose what we found, this was new to us as to how long, and that in the main there are about 16 weeks that people spend in a particular department, but we have to be flexible about that. If somebody's getting more by staying for 20 weeks, we need to allow them to stay for 20 weeks. We can't be prescriptive and say you have to move on now. Also, if somebody's bored, if it's not challenging enough for them, we've situations now where people might work across two different departments because there isn't their main rotation department hasn't enough work for them because they're. It's not challenging enough for them, so people will work across a couple of different departments.
And I can speak to the rotations as well. We like the rotations to be at least 10 weeks, because that's kind of an industry standard. But as Peter said, the goal is to teach transferable skills and to keep advancing skills. So as long as somebody is continuing to learn, we can be flexible about how long they stay, but if their interests change or they stop learning, then we need to move to another internship because it really is about them. And in Project Search, we use what's called a memo of understanding between all of our partners, because it's not only important to have the business agree to do something, but it's important to have all of the businesses for taking part kind of sign on the bottom line that they acknowledge that they will have these certain roles and responsibilities. So we do use a contract for every one of our programs.
Okay. So we ran out of time.
Can I ask one question?
I can't
here,
see
at the back.
Where is it? We don't see you.
It's here on your left.
Way in the back there.
Ah, hello. Yeah,
thank you.
My
name is Gopal from Youth for Jobs Foundation India. I have two quick questions. One is, what is the transition you see from internship to employment? And second, during internship, are they paid some remuneration or some support is given in terms of wages or, I don't know.
Sorry, was the first part just in relation to the outcomes, job outcomes?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. From CARE's perspective, we're in year four. I think I said this earlier. Year one, we had 100%. 10 people started the project. 10 people are in employment. Year two and year three, we were at 80% employment. And given that the national average in Ireland is 6%, I think that sort of demonstrates the success of it. In relation to remuneration, there is no wage, if I can put it that way, for the internship, which would be the norm in some instances. But people do get, through the Irish state, they get 18 to 24-year-olds, people with intellectual disabilities, when they leave school, they're entitled to what's called a rehabilitative training allowance. So they would get that allowance for the duration that they're on the course. But they also have access to free travel and all the other benefits that come with people.
Okay. Okay. I'm sorry, but we ran out of time. So thank you very much. I would like just to conclude and say I think that we heard many evidences today that the internship is a very effective intervention, and I think it's an innovative, and we need to see in more places this intervention, and it's a good opportunity to the person, to the intern, to get his skills, the on-job training, and also we're talking about the employers. How hard is it for them? And I think we're talking about also raising awareness and changing the mindset and the meeting between them. I think this will do the change. So thank you very much, and I hope you enjoyed yourself.